to introduce Jacob Mauer, visiting the Danforth Center today and tomorrow. He is exploring some opportunities in the IICI. Thank you all for those who are meeting with him or having meals with him. You'll find that Jacob is a very, very interesting and insightful guy. Enjoyed getting to know over the past several months. Jacob is coming to us immediately from the Gates Foundation, where he is Senior Program Officer and Senior Regional Advisor for West Africa in Agricultural Development. He's been at the foundation since 2013, where he has built up a portfolio of projects. I won't get into them, perhaps I'll mention a few of them in his presentation. For the past 25 years, though, Jacob has held a number of positions in various places around the world. He has spent a little bit of time in the U.S. prior to the Gates Foundation at places like Cornell University. But he spent a fair bit of time from 2005 to 2012 managing part and as interim director for part of that time at the African Agricultural Technology Foundation, or AATF. He took a $3.2 million program in 2005 and grew it to a $16.5 million program when he left in 2012, supporting 8 projects in 15 countries in southern, eastern, and western Africa. Jacob, the more you talk with him, the more you learn he's a builder. He didn't start off as a builder. He originated from Togo.
That's good.
Togo is wedged in between Ghana and Benin on the Gulf of Guinea in West Africa. It's a country of about 6.8 million people. And he originates from the northern part, which is bumping up against the Sahel, where agriculture is sorghum, millet, cassava, and a few other things. It's a drier region, and he has a lot of interest in agriculture in that region and like regions through sub-Saharan Africa and elsewhere in the developing world. So with that introduction, Jacob, welcome to the Danforth Center.
Thank you, Jim. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for taking your valuable time to come and listen to me this morning. It is a really a great pleasure for me to be back again at the Donald Danforth Plant Science. My first visit here was almost 10 years ago when I was at the AATF in charge of the Department of Technical Operations, having folks here working on the product development. So it was a great pleasure to come and learn how the Donald Danforth Plant Science is taking the product development scheme. So today I would like to share with you my views of what it takes to develop agricultural research organization with a lasting impact. So the conversation today will be around first, currently, what is going on in agricultural transformation in the world? Then from there, I'll share with you some principles that I think are very important to build a functional organization, looking at defining a clear strategic context, defining what the organization is, and then from then on, develop a plan to implement the strategy. I'll move from this principle to highlight what it means to achieve impact on the field. And I will give the example on the case of the Institute for International Crop Improvement, IICI, so the way these principles will apply for the organization. And I'll take some few time to share with you my experience in building innovation partnerships in Africa. At the end, I would like to share with you also my vision of the IICI and the roadmap moving forward. Before I go to share with you of what to define the context, I came last week from Nairobi, Kenya, where there was, from the 9th to 15th of September, there was a huge gathering of over 1,500 delegates and 100 media people to talk about what the name term AGREF, Alliance for Green Revolution Forum. Is a forum of government, private sector, you name it, and farmers. So this gathering of over 1,500 was the 10th anniversary of the AGRA. Does anybody know AGRA in this audience? So what is AGRA, sir? So the AGRA stands for the Alliance for a Green Revolution in Africa, term alliance. So what came clearly for that meeting was Africa as a continent, and I take that as an example, is at a crossroad in terms of finding the way of feeding its population. And the only way we can feed, Africa can feed its population and is to embrace transformation of agriculture. And the second point, which was very, very important also there, was the fact that as a global, we are confronted today as one of the biggest challenge. That is, how are we going to feed 3 billion people by 2050 in a sustainable way? During the AGREF meeting, there was a major announcement by the donors, particularly the bank, African Development Bank, that for Africa to reduce its 11 billion import of food, there must be a massive investment in agriculture. And the bank promised to put $24 billion for the coming 10 years to tackle the agricultural transformation in Africa, because this is where the need will be high moving forward. When I landed last week in Seattle on Wednesday, the first news you all are aware or heard is the acquisition of Monsanto by Bayer at a tune, as you all know, $66 billion. And what is very important there is the two giants will put together their resources in R&D and they are planning to put $2.5 billion R&D annual. So these two events are very, very important and has some significance for us here at the Danforth Center. So how do we place ourselves in this new context of agricultural transformations? How do you make sure that our vision, our mission, to look at the small-scale farmers in developing countries are met. So this is some of the areas that I would like to share with you and also hear from hear your views. So it's extremely important for any organization to define its strategic context. Otherwise, you don't know where you are going. How do you define that? Defining the strategic context by looking at what are our stakeholders' needs. These are our small-scale farmers, whether in Africa or Asia. Second, what are the challenges that our stakeholders are facing? And then the third is, based on those challenges, what are the available tools or technologies? And what are the capacities for innovations of the partners you'll be working with, the human and financial resources at hand? And last but not least, extremely important for somebody of a biophysics a background, I didn't realize until I went into development arena, that is the policy is extremely important in development arena. So no matter what you are doing, if the policies are not right, so it's almost impossible to achieve anything. So when you have defined the strategy, the next point is to look at what is your strategic direction. Defining your mission is very, very important. And then looking at what is the value proposition of this institute or this organization is providing. So what are the tangible benefits that your partners or the ultimate client are deriving from your intervention? And of course, you have to have a vision. Key point also to look at the strategic positioning. What is our role or your role or the institutional role vis-a-vis of others? Because in any given field, they also have other players. So what is your role vis-a-vis of others? And of course, last but not least, you have to define the strategic goals and the priority of intervention. So when these strategic directions and interventions are defined, it's very important to look at the organization itself, how the organization is structured, the division of work, who work where, and then look at also the systems, the processes, how things are get done in the institutions, and most important, people. People and people. Because all these organizations are working or are not working based on the people who are part of these institutions. On what are the resources at hand, both in terms of financial, capital, and others. One key point on any organization that have opportunity to work with is to define the culture, the values, and the belief of the organization. So fundamental to move forward. And of course, leadership team, the leadership and the management style, and that is critical. And then last but not least, the governance. So all these 7-point components have to be aligned with each other and also with the strategies I've just talked before to be able to have a good and smooth implementation strategy. So then when you have your operational strategy and you start implementing, you have to define the short and the long-term goals. So if there's any change, and the change will always come. So it's very important that this change trigger a check to see that whether your organization is still aligned to able to be able to address those changes. And the change will be there. So in order to generate impact in this particular sector that is important to us, this is agriculture, what are the key points we should be having in mind? Increasing productivity is a key through higher yields, through reduced post-harvest losses, and also higher value added to the product or the value chain that you're working on. It's also important to have a greater capacity of innovation. Innovation is a key to drive anything. To be able also to push for adoption of innovation is a key and fundamental. By doing that, it's also important to keep in mind and putting mechanism for sustainability of this impact to happen. In the sector that's agriculture, one of the key players is the private sector. And of course, the public sector actors plays a role, as I said earlier, in terms of policy for the government, defining the policy, which is also important. Last point here is public-private partnership. So we hear it alone. Even 2 weeks ago in Agra, the time has come for agriculture transformation, and the key platform lever will be private-public partnership. Public-private partnerships will be key moving forward. So how are these principles that I just shared with you apply or looking in the eyes of or the length of IICI? In terms of strategic context, we know that we are working in low productivity agriculture in developing countries, and we have to address those ones. And at the same time, there's a declining in public investment in research, particularly in crop improvement. As I said earlier on, with this merger of Bayer and Monsanto, there's a lot of private sector investment coming in, which is going to come in the research and R&D. So we have also to look at the opportunity to mobilize innovations in science and technology to benefit small scale farmers. So resources, tools, and means to make sure that these things happen at the small scale farmers. So in the case for IICI, in terms of strategic directions, it's going to be fundamental to identify, test, and develop products that enhance the productivity of small scale farmers. Jim, you were talking about cassava, yams, sorghum, cowpea, which are grow up in the northern part of Togo. So if you look at the productivity of these crops, some are still struggling for the past 30 years because there has not been enough resources put for research in those crops, what you call orphan crops. So it's very important that institutions like ours here are able to leverage resources to address this, what you call orphan crop productivity. It's also important to manage partnership for product development, deployment, to be able to introduce these innovations to smallholder farmer farming systems. The key point also here is all what we can do, we need to have people who know how to do it in the context to be able to address their own challenges. So building this and strengthening those scientists and the national in the national system is going to be fundamental for our ICI to make an impact. So ICI has been around maybe 15 years, Jim. Just looking at 2001, 2016, I see maybe roughly 15 years. So I think it is time, from my humble perspective, maybe to review the strategic orientation of the Institute and then also assess this, the suitability of the current organization and structure, how it will be, this structure can be able to deliver and if necessary, realign the organization structure to ensure that the goal that we set ourselves for the future are met. And then again, to achieve impact, ICI has to address problems that are important to small-scale farmers. I think this is obvious. This innovation must be designed in such a way that we address the challenges. So currently, for small-scale farmers in the poor countries, the challenges are multiple. I mean, you name it. From poor seed to non-adoption of fertilizer to non-existence of market when the farmers produce. So how do we push an ICI to be able to play its role in all this value chain, looking particularly to small-scale farmers? Partnership is needed to adopt innovations that will be generated by ICI, because there's no way in this world, if you want to take our innovation to the farmers, that we set ourselves as the ultimate customers. There's no way that one institution alone can do it. Let's forget it. So partnership is going to be key, and my presentation and my team will be alliance, 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 partnership to move forward. So ICI must work with partners to be able to leverage their resources in order to meet its objective. And also, we need to attract highly qualified staff, human resources. Key important is how do we diversify our donor bases? Currently, we have three major sources. We have to look how best we can leverage other donors, being also from public or private foundations. In the continent, there's a lot of change, I said earlier on, in terms of looking at funds that's coming from CADAP. CADAP is a comprehensive African agricultural development program. This is a program that the fifth head of state of Africa agreed that this is what we are going to do to advance agriculture in the continent. And this is the target we set ourselves we are going to do so that we can hold accountable each other of making sure that we realize those objectives. You have some donors like IFAD, International Fund for Agricultural Development, and then also some regional financial institutions. We need to be aware of their play. We need to seek the best way to approach them to harness and then and tap on the resources that they have, the financial resources. Then African Development Bank, and then in Asia, we have our Asian Development Bank. And one key also player is the Islamic Development Bank. We have a lot of resources. We just put a plan called Life and Livelihood Funds to a tune of $2.5 billion for access by Islamic State in our countries in Africa and in Asia to tackle issues of agriculture, health, infrastructure. So the agriculture sector is quite also a component. So these are the resources that are there. So I think the ICI should be looking forward to see how we can tap on those resources. And of course, develop plan for private sector investment is going to be important. At this point, I would like to share with you briefly some of my experience in building innovation partnership because I believe in those partnership. I will talk about the WEMA, the Water Efficient Maize for Africa, then an example of insect-resistant cowpea program, the disease-resistant insect in Ethiopia, and the program that at the foundation we call the PEARL program, which aims to strengthen the national scientist capacity in biotechnology. So the Water Efficient Maize for Africa program started in 2005, and the objective is a public-private partnership to develop and deploy royalty-free African drought tolerance and insect-based maize varieties. So here again, the objective is clear: to increase the yield stability and to reduce the risk under the drought conditions. The clear product from this project was to produce and still conventional hybrid, maize hybrid, as well as a transgenic drought-tolerant maize hybrid for Africa. The partner was AATF, African Agricultural Technology Foundation, CIMIT, is an international maize and wheat improvement institute based in Mexico. Our neighbor just across the road here, Monsanto, and the National Agriculture Research System country, five countries in East Africa. Again, for the project to be able to deliver was organized in teams, the product development team, the regulatory team, because these are biotech, and also the IP issues coming in, and as well as at the end towards the deployment. Because at the end of the day, whatever product you have able to produce, you have to deploy it. How do you bring in private sector seed companies to take this the material to the farmers? Initially, the first phase of the project was $45 million. To the best of my knowledge, in 2005, this was one of the biggest funded projects I've ever come across in my career. So as you can see, this is all the partners there, from the Kenya Agricultural Research Institute, KARI, and the COSTECH for Tanzania, the NARU from Uganda, the YAM from Mozambique, and the South African ARCN, CIMIT, as I said, Monsanto, and led by AATF. So far, this project is now 8 years on the run. It was able to deliver conventional drought-tolerance maize with trade mark drought Tego. So 45 hybrids have been commercialized. And currently also, because of a new diseases which appeared in East Africa, the maize, lethal necrosis, MLN virus. So it was important to incorporate this trait into the hybrids. And this was done is going through certification to be delivered to the seed companies. And the last product we still under development is the transgenic component. There is some product from that currently being released in South Africa, because right now in sub-Saharan Africa, it's only South Africa that have the regulation and to be able to commercialize transgenic crops. So hopefully that by year 2017 and 18, the other African countries like Kenya, Uganda, hopefully Mozambique, will be able to put in, to authorize the deployment of this transgenic. So currently, these materials are being tested under under a controlled environment in these five countries. So the, this is the funding, roughly. The first phase was $44 million. The current phase is $57 million. And so the investors, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Howard J. Buffett, and then USAID. So just to give you what the team look like to be able to deliver this plan. So we have the NAS, personnel for the NAS, the scientists, the seed companies, and so on and so forth. So this is a type of team that I was given the responsibility to coordinate or to manage during my tenure at AATF. So I think I can go. So the second experience I want to share with you is leadership is a coordinating mechanism platform to develop the BT cowpea. Cowpea is in the US is called black eyed pea. It's a very important legume crop in the tropics in Africa. And one of the major constraints to the production of a cowpea is a Maruca pod borer. It's an insect that bores into the flowers and destroys the flowers. So this is the, you can see the insect here. This is the Maruca insect, and then there's the flower here of cowpea. And this is the way it looks like when the damage is being made by this insect. Classically, when you have a problem of insect, so we have to look first in the germplasm. Is there any natural resistant germplasm that you can be used to make your crosses? But unfortunately, after screening 84,000 accessions worldwide of cowpea, there was no single source of resistance to this insect in the germplasm. So therefore, there was no option left to breeder than going through the biotechnology option. So the objective here was to develop a high quality insect resistant cowpea for use by small scale farmer in West Africa. So I'm putting this slide to show you the platform, the partners, what needs to be put in place to be able to deliver it. So, and of course, in this case, the technology, the BT technology was owned and is by Monsanto. Monsanto provided it a license to AATF. So then AATF, as coordinator, was leading this institution. So we now sub-license to in institutions in CSIRO in Australia, the laboratory of Dr. T.J. Higgins. He was able to put the BT into the cowpea, make the transformation, and then for five consecutive years make testing in the field and also selecting some of the best line for to introgress in the varieties that farmers likes. So, of course, this has been done with collaboration with the national partners in Burkina Faso and Ghana and Nigeria. And then again, the next step is on-farm demonstrations, taking care of consumer acceptance, seed distribution, easy to say and very difficult to put in place for cowpea, which is not like maize, not a lot of interest. And also products, especially because these are GM crops. So this is a platform that's been in place to develop this product, the Moroccan resistant cowpea. And again, I would like to show you this slide to point out, I mean, how many resources in terms of human are behind this project. And I'm sure some of you can remember this gentleman here. So he's Jeff, who has been helping the regulatory component of this project. So the point here is for the International Institute for Crop Improvement to be able to make impact on the ground on the small-scale farmers, there will be a need to be selectively looking at the partners and bring those partners on the ground to make and build what I call alliance of the winners. So this is fundamental, and this is where we should be moving forward. The third point I want to share with you here is the experience in building innovation partnership, looking at strengthening the national scientist capacity. Again, as I said earlier on, it's going to be very important to develop the technology here in the ICI, in the Danforth Center. Fundamentally, it's going to be very important to have partners in the countries where we want this technology to be able to take this technology, being trained, and being capable of really delivering this technology on the ground. So for that to happen, when I joined the Gate Foundation 3 years ago, there was a call from the government of Ethiopia to build a capacity in molecular biology, a transgenic technology, and also build a capacity to be able to modify the biosafety law, which was made so stringent that even a student could not make experiment in the lab, otherwise he or she will go to jail. So then I designed this project and then look at what is a very important crop for a small-scale farmer in Ethiopia. Because it's important to see what is on the ground. So we selected with a colleague from Ethiopia, Anset. Anset is a kind of a false banana. It looks like a banana, but it doesn't produce any fruit. So what is the edible part is the corn. It's a very starchy corn. This is where the women can grab the corn here, starchy, and process it for consumption. So at the same time, the key constraint for Anset was the bacterial wilt. So here you can see a nice-looking Anset plant, and this is a disease plant by bacterial wilt. So you can see that completely this plant is being disseminated and completely destroyed. So the point was to build the capacity of the Ethiopian Institute of Agriculture Research, the Holeta Research Center, to be able to use the modern biotechnology tools to conduct transgenic research in their own country. By doing so, also provide evidence-based approach for them to modify their own regulations. So this is how the biotechnology facilities look like in Ethiopia. And this is the molecular lab in the facilities. So we have clearly a good, I would say, classical tissue culture facilities. These are some Anset material multiplied in the lab. And the two scientists are currently being trained in Baker, IIT Baker, to not only multiply the onset, but do the transgenic and develop the transgenic materials in Ethiopia. So you can see how this lab has been changed and completely well finished. So extremely important that this type of capacity building being done in the country so that when we put the alliance together, we are talking with people who have the same skills to be able to advance the technology. So in terms of resource management, as Jim said at some point, as executive director, I manage staff and also play a key, try to advance biotechnology through what we call the Open Forum for Agricultural Biotechnology, which is a forum in the various countries to explain to people what biotechnology is about, so that people don't think that, I mean, when you have a GM crop, whether it's a banana or tomato, it can start growing some ears or whatever it is. So, and also, I was able to mobilize resources for the program. And currently at the foundation, I'm managing a portfolio of $30 million a year, supporting both the Ethiopian type of institutions that I've just mentioned, as well as the government of Nigeria to be able to articulate clearly their strategy in terms of agriculture and putting in place good policy in agriculture sector. It's very, very important. So I worked in many countries in Africa, and outside Africa, I started my career in Europe, where I did my undergraduate, my graduate studies and work at a private company called Petrofina in those days. I worked in the US and also partnered in Latin America with people of diverse culture and multidisciplinary teams. I speak a bit of English and also some French, and also very fluent in five African languages. So I think that's going to be very handy for me in this new position if I were offered the opportunity to serve. I'll repeat it again. I think it's going to be fundamental that to be able to deliver on the mission of the Danfoss Center, we need to collaborate with the NAS scientists in Africa and Southeast Asia. Building capacity with the NAS is something that I've done and I hope continue to do. Addressing many issues and constraints like your financial management, particularly when you are working with the national programs, you have to help them put the financial system to a point where they're able not only to report on the technical part, but financial reporting is also important. And to hold people accountable in terms of delivery of the product and output, when you make a grant. Some of the NAS, the national partners, have huge problem in procurement of services and goods. So how do you help them navigate the system on procurement? I've got friends from some country like Ethiopia. We have serious difficulty importing gold, so how do you help them to get that? And also communication is a key and a fundamental, because whatever you say in this arena can be misinterpreted, misthrown, and you can really, you don't want to be start doing damage control. So we have to be very, very important what you say and to whom you say it and how you put it. And particularly in the culture, and various cultures have different way of saying things. So be mindful of that. It's going to be really critical for this position. So this is the mission of the Danfoss Center. Just pull it from the website. This mission, I buy to it, and I really like it, and it's really resonated with me. And particularly the second one, harnessing science and technology to improve conditions of human beings, particularly the poor smallholder farmers in developing countries. When I was preparing my CV 15 years ago, so exactly the second point is what I put as my goal. This is what I was aspiring. And then When I went to look at the Darfur Center website and said, I said, my goodness, I don't know, maybe I just put it there or who put it first, but at least it's exactly matching 100% of what my goal is moving forward. What part I can play moving forward, and of course, in the area of genetics and genomics for crop improvements, is going to be very fundamental. It's going to be also fundamental to prioritize and look at what exactly do we want to do to move forward. So defining this clearly is going to be fundamental. As I said, the world is changing. Many players on the ground. So where are we going to play and how are we going to win? There are three key points I would like you to take from this conversation, which is very dear to me. What I call the three P's. Plant science, so this is what we do very best here. Discovery. People are going to be fundamental. Both scientists and the structures. How do we make partners? How do we build the next generation of scientists? Because some of us are now aging and we need some young scientists to take up the challenges as we move forward in the continent or even Southeast Asia. And the product, of course. Currently, our strategy is focused on few crops. So do we explore some crop which might be linked to livestock? So these are some of the questions that I'm posing and looking forward to conversation. So as I said, there are so many players. From my humble view is this is where we will be playing as the RICI, taking the advantage of what we do best in terms of accessing the latest advances in science and technology, particularly on advancing breeding and genomics tools. I think this is where what we can offer to the world moving forward. And how we will help to win, because as again, I'll say help, because we have to be really realistic, because as alone, we cannot do it. Foster a unique and innovative partnership with partners in developing countries to take these innovations to the farmers and demonstrate impact on the field to improve the livelihood and the lives of small-scale farmers. So this is what I think we can help as an institution. Currently, we are, as ICI, in 16 countries. So maybe it's time to also look at it and then see whether we focus or we extend. So this is some based, of course, from the resources. Currently, I look forward to be able to propose that we look at our international relationship. Look at the players who are on the ground, like FARA, the Forum for African Africa Research Organization, is very, very important. The National Agricultural Research System, the NAS, the CGR centers, like CIMIT, like RIT, the International Agricultural Research Center in UK. I have here in mind the John Innes Center. I think that's something that we could look at, the universities, and also maybe widen our partnership and particular target partnership in some countries like Germany, France, and EU. Japan is coming on also heavily in Africa, and in early September, there was a big conference in Nairobi where Japan came strongly to say they were going to invest in Africa. So I think the time has come for us to explore all these opportunities. Japan can also be a good partner. Australia, some science and technology. Can we link with the Canberras, the QETs, the New Zealand? So in terms of funding, our current funding organizations are the top three, BMGF, USAID, and some gift. I think this is going to be important if I've offered this opportunity to explore new funding organizations. I'm thinking of African Development Bank. I think I've already mentioned this to you. The the Asian Development Bank, the EU, the Islamic Development Bank, and others. So quickly, my vision for 2025 can be subdivided into very short 2017-2018, review the current ICI strategy direction and assess the resources that we have in hand, rebrand maybe ICI to make it more visible. So as we go to look at resources, it's very important that we rebrand ourselves and develop and implement the resource mobilization strategy is going to be very fundamental if you want to really move forward. Keep in mind that we should also build maybe a kind of evaluation, monitoring evaluation and learning systems as we operate. By 2018-2022, I think this will going to be our really growth period because some of the innovations that the institute is developing should be taken to the farmers. I'm now having in mind the Cassava Africa project. And of course, hopefully by 2022-25, we will start reaping the benefit on our investment and also consolidate our success. Overall, I want to summarize my vision for IICI as the preferred center or the to-go center for developing countries. So this is what I want this institution moving forward to be, the place where anywhere in the world, in terms of crop improvement, this is the go-to, particularly from the developing country, go-to IICI, the default center. So for the coming 5 years, humbly I'm putting some key points I'm sharing with you, which is develop again necessary partnership, strategic partnership with the institution on the ground like ABNE, AATF, IIT, BECA, and so on and so forth. At some point, I think it's going to be very important that we think of increasing the number of product of the project. So currently, maybe you are heavily on cassava. I think at some point we should be looking at extend maybe sorghum, cowpea, and of course recruit additional expert scientists as we move forward. So this is the role that was defined for this job: plan, develop, manage, subcontract, and coordinate. So I have the opportunity during my career to do some of this, which I've just shared with you. So brief, the question is why maybe you think that maybe Jacob is could be a potential candidate for this. So in terms of leadership skills, I'm a consensus builder. So I had a student association in Belgium when I was a student. I was the head of biotechnology research at IIT in the 90s, as director of AATF. Also play a role as executive director for more than a year, and currently at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. I have a passion for international development, there's no doubt about that. This is what I've been doing for the past 33 years. And the IICI goals and mission is really dear to me and aligned to what I aspire to move forward. I think in terms of my personal qualities, what I like the most is a strong will. I always be positive in life. So no matter how the difficulty is, there's a way to look at this in a positive angle. I work hard, I persevere, and I think I'm very, very excited about this opportunity to join the Danforth Center if offered, to be able to build the ICI as a go-to organization, as I said. And again, I would like to take this time to thank you all for listening to me, and I'm now open for questions. Thank you very much.
Questions. Why don't you talk about the role of non-GM technologies, the range of non-GM, and the challenges with GM technologies in a very heterogeneous geographical landscape? For example, should we even be doing anything in the GM area in the future if we're going to be suffering a lot of delays and uncertainties.
Jim, this is a question that I've posed myself many times. When I've been confronted for the past 15 years or with the challenges that comes with the baggage that comes with the GM technology. And of course, for the classical breeding using the new tools of genomics, it's, I would say, is easy to sell. Even I was reading a document and, by Greenpeace on using the norm marker assay selection and so on. For those type of technology or tools, there's no issue at all. So you can move forward. You don't need to, there's no hassle for that. But when I joined AATF, the core mission is to be able to bring in new innovation technology embedded in the seed through biotechnology. So the hurdle was, how do you make sure, first, that people understand what this is about? How do you put in place a biosafety regulation which is conducive even just to do the research? So at some point, you feel maybe you just drop the towel and do the easy things. But I don't believe in that, because things are changing. Things are changing in Bangladesh. And things are changing in Africa, because South Africa has been the frontier for GM. And the country which is above my small Togo country, Burkina Faso, has made a tremendous jump in accepting at least a non-food, quote-unquote, GM technology, which is cotton. And right now, in Nigeria, we have been working hard. People are, Nigeria are now accepted to do transgenic. So it's tough, but it's coming. So should we drop the towel? I'll say no. It is true in a sense that not only once, because you cannot fix. If you take a car, okay, you have the engine, you have the tires. So if you fix, somebody will tell you, no, the problem of the car is only the engine. If you fix the engine, the whole thing will work. The same system applies, and everybody can make this argument, that with the current seed systems, with the farmers access, even the non-improved varieties, if you take care of the market, so they can produce and sell. And somebody will say, yes, so to produce in a profitable way, you need the farmers to have access to the seed, to the fertilizer, and to the know-how to produce the seed, because things are changing. So this is why it's very, very important that when you come to this argument, depending on where you sit, I will always say that you have to look at this as a whole, I will think. Because fixing only the seed system will not take you anywhere. The environment, the policy environment, which the government determines, will determine what type of fertilizers, what is the access to the market, what is the price of the market. So all this has to be aligned in order for a small-scale farmer, not only to produce enough for her, in most cases, to feed their family, but to derive some surplus to take to the market. So my point here is provide everything that the small-scale farmer look not only at one segment of the value chain, no matter what crop that he or she is producing, look at the whole. Fixing one without the other, just almost as doing nothing. The way you start building your alliance is to look at what is the partner's capacity or what he or she is bringing on the table. So if you define any commodity or any crop or any region that you are working, you'll do your, the context analysis will tell you that if you want to operate in China, you need this company in China, which knows the environment and which is capable of doing this. The same applies to Africa or South Asia. So in Africa, I say that if I'm in Africa, I want to do a crop improvement, who are they and who are the capable person? So then you approach them, and then you sit down and say, we want, I know from what you are doing that you can offer A, B, and C. We can provide D, E, and F. So putting together, we can develop a platform and move forward. So that's the step, and it takes time. Don't get me wrong. But this is what needs to be done. That's why it takes sometime 1 year or 2 years to be able to identify the right partner, build the consensus, and then try to work together, because you are talking about two or three or five different institutions with different values. So making sure that they come together and then having the same way of operating is something that you have to work on and build on. It takes time and energy and money.
Respect the schedule, so please join me in thanking Jacob.
Thank you.